Do you have low energy, no sex drive, poor sleep? Are you suffering from hair loss? Are you gaining weight? Do you have poor tolerance to heat or cold? You might have an undiagnosed thyroid issue. And even those that do see doctors tend to get blanket treated with synthetic thyroid hormones such as Synthroid, but taking a medication isn't going to alleviate an inflammatory lifestyle. The two most common diagnoses for thyroid issues are Graves' disease and Hashimoto's disease, which is hyperthyroid, overactive thyroid, and hypothyroid, underactive thyroid. Both of these are caused by autoimmunity, where the body attacks itself, in this case, the thyroid. Autoimmunity is caused by, you know, inflammatory factors in the diet and lifestyle. You know, doctors will tell you it's genetic, but, you know, that is what justifies them to give you medications and do procedures. Thyroid issues are more prevalent in women as they're more susceptible to iodine deficiency due to them having breast tissue, and estrogen has an effect on thyroid function, reducing the effectiveness of certain hormones produced by the thyroid. Some of you might have heard that low carb might make these issues worse, you know, whether you're following a ketogenic diet or a carnivore diet. And there might be some truth to this, but what's more likely is that your thyroid issues were going under the radar when you were following a standard American diet because there were so many other negative health issues you were suffering from being on a standard American diet. That being said, you know, you could have all of these issues and it might not be your thyroid. It could be your adrenals, it could be your pituitary. There's many overlapping things that manifest themselves from modern problems. That being said, the things we're going over today will likely fix, you know, whatever issues you're having, even if your thyroid isn't the root cause. So, you know, this video is definitely not inclusive to someone that thinks they have a hypothetical thyroid problem. And I really want to emphasize that point. There are a lot of issues that people can suffer from that manifest themselves in similar ways, and you really want to identify the root cause, what the true problem was. That also includes blood work. You know, a lot of doctors will test your thyroid hormones, but you have to do a full thyroid write-up to really figure out what's going on. You know, most doctors aren't going to be testing for TPO antibodies, thyroid antithyroglobulin activity, RT3, TBG, TSI. These things can tell you if, you know, there are estrogen mimickers in your lifestyle, if you do have a thyroid issue, because, you know, your TSH could be completely normal for 10, 15 years, and your problems will be undiagnosed by the average medical doctor. Unfortunately, you know, most doctors aren't up to date on the current medical literature. That has to do with, you know, information from medical school being outdated dozens of years. And even if you do find a good doctor, a specialist, you know, those people tend to be booked out months in advance. It's why, you know, people like me and you tend to have to self-diagnose our own issues and do a lot of research online. Those same doctors will tell you that, oh, your thyroid issues are stress, it's all on your head, it's psychological, and yeah, when my liver was turning into a solid chunk of iron, the doctors I was going to were telling me that it was all psychological. However, there is some truth to stress. I personally believe stress equals a high EMF environment. If you're living in a city, if you're at work, these people tend to be around, you know, cell phones, Wi-Fi, lots of low-level electromagnetic fields that are non-native to humans. It's not something we're supposed to be exposed to. And when you go into an x-ray, you put on a lead vest. A cell phone is essentially a low-level x-ray. It's just they're telling you it's safe because it's killing you slowly instead of, you know, giving you brain cancer in 2 years. Although, you know, there are people who live next to cell towers that do get brain cancer in 2 years. And I'm sure many of you have anecdotal stories where you go on vacation and you feel a lot better. It's not because of the stress. It's because where you went on vacation was a low EMF environment. You know, there were no cell phones, no cell towers, much lower levels of these fields. And you may also have heavy metals present in your diet or lifestyle. And the amount of heavy metals in your body, like iron, aluminum, mercury, amalgam fillings from past dental work, can make you more sensitive to these fields. And it's also very genetically based. Some people are far more sensitive to it than others. And the solution to this is obviously, you know, remove those heavy metals, make sure you're following a balanced diet, and turn electronics off at night if possible. This is huge, and You know, just reducing EMF in the environment tends to fix most people's health issues, believe it or not. This is definitely overlooked by most people, but it is the most important thing to address in your lifestyle. Then we have the diet. Most people are familiar with common inflammatory culprits, refined foods, certain grains, vegetable seed oils. Those cause inflammation from an input standpoint, you know, whereas too much sugar can cause dysbiosis, overgrowth of bad gut bacteria, as well as spike insulin, which leads to inflammation. You can also have certain anti-nutrients such as lectins, phytic acid, that can contribute to leaky gut, furthering inflammation. Chances are you've been following a high carbohydrate diet for a period of time and you would benefit from restricting them in some capacity, but this doesn't necessarily mean go full carnivore. That being said, thyroid hormones are needed to metabolize carbohydrates, so there can be a lot of, you know, inflammatory factors in the diet that do cause autoimmunity. But something more important that is not mentioned often is halogen toxicity. And I learned this from Dr. David Brownstein, who has some great research on iodine. Fluoride and chlorine are in our water supply, and bromide is in our food supply, as well as a bunch of packaged goods. You know, even when you're taking a shower, you're dousing yourself in chlorine. These elements are in the halogen family, and they bind to iodine receptors, replacing iodine where it should be. That's why when some people supplement iodine, they report flu-like symptoms or they feel really crappy for a few days to a few weeks. This is actually your body detoxing the halogens that our government has been poisoning us with. You know, I mean, it's crazy what people can get away with. And you have the sheeple recommending that, oh, you should use fluoride in your toothpaste because it'll make your teeth nice and healthy. It's completely ridiculous. And obviously, if your thyroid is full of poisonous halogens, it's not going to function properly and your body might attack it. So this is why I suggest people only drink well water, spring water, or a bottled mineral water. And consuming seafood, especially seaweed or shellfish, are great sources of iodine. And there are many trace minerals that work synergistically with iodine, in particular selenium. So you can't just really supplement iodine. It has to be, you know, a full lifestyle change. And you want to be careful with this. You don't just want to start supplementing iodine off the bat. What you want to do is you want to remove the halogens from your diet and lifestyle first. And then after a couple weeks to a couple months of being certain that you've removed them, then you can start increasing the iodine consumption. Now, we can't overlook the nutrient density of the diet in general, because hypothetically, on paper, if you're getting all the vitamins, minerals, fatty acids your body needs, you should fix all of your health issues. It's just people think they're doing that, but they're missing the few elements that end up being the missing links. If you don't have all of the nutrients, the building blocks your body needs, you cannot perform basic metabolic processes. This could be as simple as a B vitamin deficiency. Nutrients that are specifically important to thyroid health are iodine, selenium, vitamin D, and magnesium. Selenium working synergistically with iodine and magnesium with vitamin D. I recommend using high quality animal foods and getting plenty of sun. Vitamin D can be supplemented, as many people don't have access to sunlight or the time to tan every day. Iodine can be supplemented as well under those conditions of halogen toxicity, but really you want to obtain the nutrients in whole food forms, because when you supplement, you can throw things out of balance and cause other issues that you wish you didn't have. Third, we want to remove endocrine disruptors, which are estrogen mimickers. Estrogen has been shown to decrease iodine uptake, as well as increase cell growth in certain cancers. Birth control taken by women, you know, would explain all of the breast cancer, all of the Hashimoto's diagnoses, and that birth control ending up in our water supply would explain the soy boy epidemic. Atrazine is something you guys have heard me talk a lot about. It's an estrogenic herbicide, particularly contained in feedlot meat. It's because, you know, they spray the corn, the soy, the grasses that they feed to these animals with atrazine to fatten them up. And that meat, when consumed, gives you the estrogen. Not good. There's also exposure to PCBs, which are chemical compounds that were banned several dozen years ago, yet they still contaminate our environment. These have been shown to reduce thyroid hormone levels. You have polybrominated diphenyl ethers, which is contained in fabrics, plastics, paint, various electronic devices, mattresses. which actually have a similar chemical structure to T4, disrupting thyroid function. You have perchlorate, which is contained in fertilizers and airbags that inhibits the iodine receptors. You have BPA and phthalates, which is in toys, cosmetics, tubes, food, packaging. It's used in buildings and construction. These reduce hormone levels and iodine uptake. You have pesticides, insecticides, fungicides. Some have similar structures to thyroid hormones. There are many different types that have been shown to damage the thyroid in different ways. You have glyphosate, a toxic herbicide, which is also an endocrine disruptor. That's one of the more popular ones. You guys can imagine there are so many things in our modern food supply, in our lifestyle, that are disrupting our thyroid function. It's amazing that anyone has a functioning thyroid. So we have to identify these and remove them from the diet. The best way to do this is really buy food from a local farm, only consume organic foods, avoid plastic as much as possible, consume a high quality bottled mineral water, well water, spring water. All of these things are necessary because of what our government has allowed us to consume. So there are a couple supplements that might help you along the way here. I know we mentioned selenium, we mentioned iodine, we mentioned vitamin D3. Cod liver oil is like a great combination of all of these things. I think if you had like a can or two of cod liver a week, that really might help you alleviate your thyroid issues. It is important to note that the liver is crucial for the activation of thyroid hormone. So using things like ox bile, betaine HCL, taking various digestive enzymes is very important. I mean, you know, if you're doing all these things, if you're reducing EMF in the environment, if you're consuming high quality foods, but your body is so damaged, you're not able to process them, you might need a couple of things to help you along the way. So I hope this helps some of you guys out. Again, the three main things to address are, you know, remove the stress from the lifestyle, reduce the EMF in the environment, address the diet, remove the endocrine disruptors. You know, exercise can help to some degree. You know, obviously sleeping better can help to some degree. But addressing all of these things, you know, should improve those aspects as well as, you know, whatever issues you're having here. So thanks again for joining me, guys. If you want to support me further, please check out my book, The Ancestral Indigenous Diet, down in the description below. Of course, guys, please like the video, subscribe if you haven't, definitely hit that bell icon. And above all, if you can, share the video. You guys enjoy the rest of your day.